God morning. Oops, I meant good morning. Today we're going to hear and perhaps talk about the G word. My friend Reverend Tom, you're going to meet in a minute, even has the G word in the title of his sermon. And I got to tell you all, I'm here for it. I told you a few months ago when I started this position that I identified as a UU Jew boo woo woo. And another thing, I believe in God. But in my spiritual journey in Unitarian Universalism, I haven't always felt welcomed. Sometimes I've felt people sort of look down on me because I believe in God. I would sort of get petted by others and put aside for my irrational beliefs and experiences. In UUSM, we draw from six sources within a living tradition of wisdom and spirituality. Our first source says, direct experiencing of that transcending mystery and wonder affirmed in all cultures, which moves us to a renewal of the spirit and an openness to the forces which create and uphold life. I have a direct experience and relationship with transcending mystery and wonder. It is active in my human experience. I am open to the forces which create and uphold life. This is for me what I mean to say when I say I believe in God. We have to stop as Unitarian Universalists judging that reason and science, which are among our other sources, are superior to transcending mystery and wonder. In Islamic traditions, they hold that there are 99 names for God. In the Hebrew Bible, it has 42 names for God. I want to know why in so many UU spaces we have trouble even saying the word God, when the origins of Unitarianism believed that there was one God and rejected the Trinity, but there was God. Universalists believe that with a loving God, everyone would be and is redeemed. There is no hell. There is no original sin. So how did it come to pass that believing in God or saying God in some UU spaces became unacceptable? I wish that when someone says they believe in God, or our imaginations would tell us that we actually have no idea what that person means when they say God, and start asking questions and be curious. If we truly want to be a diverse community in UU spaces, if we want to grow our faith, we have to reimagine ourselves willing to sit openly with others and listen to their views of God and their direct experience with the divine. We do not need to agree, but our principles encourage us to covenant together with our values. So let me tell you about the woo-woo part of my divinity. I don't believe it's just me here alone. I believe I have help. I believe there is something bigger than myself that is so mystical and wondrous that it causes me to feel direct experience with the divine. And that gives me hope. And I have tons of hope.
The chalice lighting words come to us from May Sarton. I would like to believe when I die that I have given myself away, like a tree that sows seeds every spring and never counts the loss, because it is not loss. It is adding to future life. It is a tree's way of being, strongly rooted, but spilling out its treasure on the wind.
There's not enough room. Okay. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Santa Monica. I'm Amy Brunell, and I go by the pronouns she, her. And I am your worship associate for today. Today, I do want to welcome virtually my friend, which he's not there now, but he'll be there, Reverend Tom Owen-Towle. Oh, there he is. Hi, Tom. I was lucky to be at many camps with Tom and his lovely wife, the Reverend Carolyn, and very wise, lovely people who are agreeing to do some mentoring with me in my new journey. Reverend Tom is entering his 56th year of ordained ministry and is the author of 24 books on personal relationships, social justice challenges, and spiritual growth. Tom and his life partner, the ever so cool Reverend Dr. Carolyn Sheets Owen-Towle, are the active parents of 4 children, 7 grandchildren, and 1 great-grandchild. Tom is a guitarist and a parlor magician who in refirement, he says, refirement, sings with seniors, mentors youth, and volunteers with San Diego's homeless. He also lectures and conducts workshops on the core themes of conscious aging and mindful dying. We are delighted to have all of you here with us, wherever you are in the sanctuary or online. Hi, everyone. So glad you're here. If you're new to a community, we'll find many ways to learn more about us and become involved through our website. Please know that while we are in the process of reopening for larger services and events, we are here in person doing some things like coffee afterwards, slightly differently, and also still holding many meetings and gatherings online. Thank goodness for Zoom. Hey, and if anyone used to use the restrooms, want to explain that, there's one back over there, and then there's one in that building over there, and ask anybody, we'll tell you where they are. We offer programs to serve the needs of our congregation and to be of service to the larger world, including broad religious education and exploration, personal development for people of all ages, and we also join with other social advocates in the world to bring harmony to all of us. Unitarian Universalism is not defined by creed or dogma, but is guided by 7, soon to be 8 principles that affirm the worth and dignity of every person and encourage an individual's search for truth and meaning. We honor the wonder of existence and believe that we are all connected to each other and to this interdependent web of life. Our beliefs come from 6 sources that are drawn from scripture and science, nature and philosophy, personal experience, and ancient tradition. We are an open, affirming, and welcoming congregation diverse in backgrounds, identities, spiritualities, and philosophies of life. We are united in our desire to create an inclusive, beloved community, to live the principles of our faith, and to serve the wider world. Whatever your beliefs or faith tradition, we invite you to help us build a community where together, in our diversity, we may covenant and love and justice. May you find comfort and camaraderie and inspiration here. We gather in this space and in our virtual spaces, we recognize that we are also connected through one another, through the winds that give air to all beings, and through the waters that are deeply moving in the earth and up to the sky. We acknowledge that the ground beneath our feet is always and has been the home of indigenous people, many of whom have been forcibly removed to other lands. Announcements, announcements, announcements. None of you sing that song? What a horrible way to die. Okay, yeah, camp song, camp song. I'm gonna get to that in a minute. First of all, I was just whispered that we do have childcare today. So after our covenant and singing, if anybody wants to take advantage of that, we have that. Today, women of UUSM unite, because today after our services, we're going to meet in our newly formed women's committee with a potluck lunch, and you're invited to come even if you didn't bring anything, okay? Just come, all right? And we wanna tell you if you identify as a woman, or you're gender fluid, or you're gender queer, or you're non-binary, we hope that you'll join us for victuals. Is it victuals? How do you say that word? Vittles? See, I can never be president because I mispronounce words all the time. And visioning. We'll meet today in the shade structure at 2 and share, and then we're also going to do postcard writing to 12:30 to encourage Florida voters to participate in the August primary, and that's really exciting. And if you want to be involved in any of that, that woman right there, Jackie, is the person to go to. Hey, we never announced this, but I just thought we should also say that we also have a men's group. And they'll be gathering this week, Thursday the 4th at 1:30 p.m. Their topic is really kind of a camp. So? 7:30. It said in the announcements 4:30, but that's okay. We'll fix it. 7:30 on Zoom. Anything else? Okay, your topic this week is about socializing with games. I thought that was a really cool topic because I think it's a really great notion, and I just was at a week of our DeBeneville Pines camp where I played the most hilarious games all week, and I laughed and laughed and laughed, so that's the best. So anyway, come to the men's group. Speaking of which camp, look at this, you guys. Look what I just did. Tom, you'll be so impressed. I just made this. It's a tie-dye bag, and if you want to come to camp, I'll be auctioning it off, okay? So I have other things to auction, but you know, I just want to tell you, I've been tie-dyeing, my fingers still look a little funny. So we have a camp, and we will be there in September. Please sign up. Chayla is here today, and so we'll be doing sign-ups for that. And also, I want to announce that, Greg's going to be doing sign-up. Oh, I got so many people. I love it. And then I also want to announce that adult camp is coming August 12th through August 16th, and our guest minister is going to be up there with his wife as well and singing songs and doing ministry. And so anyway, that's kind of a cool thing to come to, and it's just adults. So that's really fun. And lastly, we are still doing postcards for UU The Vote. What's our goal, Jack?
1,500 by next week.
1,500 by next week. How close are we, Jackie?
We're
1,200. We can do it. And we give you like colored pens, and we give you the script, and we put little stickers. And it's not to get people to vote in a specific manner, but just to get them vote at all. And it's really, really well organized and well done, and we're so lucky. So please contact Jackie if you would like to participate for that. So that was a lot. But let's rise in body and spirit, and let's sing I've Got Peace Like a River. And then stay standing for our covenant and song today.
Thank you.
sit. If we have donations for the food bank, we can do them now. We're trying a new way with me doing this on computer, so we'll see how that goes. So I found this really cool story on the UUA website by a woman named Mary Ann Moore, and it's called Hide and Seek with God. Once upon a time, God said, I am bored because I don't have anything to do and I want to play with my friends. And because God is God, as soon as the words were spoken, God's friends were there. When God saw them all gathered, God said, I've been bored because I haven't had anything to do. Let's play something. Good idea, said God's friends. What should we play? God thought for a minute and said, I know. Let's play hide and seek. The friends all said, yay! I mean, they knew what hide and seek was, and with God was always exciting and different because God was the one who hid, and God always thought of wonderful places to hide. God's friends closed their eyes tight and counted to 10, and when they opened their eyes, God wasn't there anymore. So they went off to look for God. One friend decided to look close on the earth and soon came to a meadow. As he was searching, he stopped to admire the tender new sprouts of green grass pushing their way up the sun. And as he bent over to look more closely at the tender green, he realized that there was something special and amazing and wonderful about it. So he jumped up and ran back to home base calling, I found God! It's green and it's growing! I found God in the grass! Another one of God's friends decided to look for God in the night. She watched the sun go down and heard the workaday noises stop and saw the lights in the houses go on. And as it got darker and the peaceful night wrapped itself around her, she listened very hard. And then she realized that there was something special and amazing and wonderful about it. And when it was so still, she could hear nothing at all. She suddenly jumped home, ran to home base, calling out, I found God. God is dark and peaceful. I found God in the night. A third friend looked on the earth and felt the mystery of the grass growing toward the sun, and he stayed and watched the night come on, and he felt the mystery of the darkness and the stars, and he thought to himself, these mysteries are special and amazing and wonderful. But when he finally came back to home base, he said, I found wonderful mysteries, but I'm not sure if I want to call them God. A fourth friend decided to look for God where the people were. He joined a group of people going home from work and went with them to the store where they bought food. He went with them back on the street as they started for their homes. He was with them when someone came up and said, please, I'm very hungry. Could you share a little food with me? The people readily agreed as he watched them share, and he realized that there was something special and amazing and wonderful about these people. He turned around and ran home to home base and said, I found God! God is love. And sharing, I found God in people who care for others. Finally, two more of God's friends, a boy and a girl, decided to look for God together. After a time, they came to a house and they decided to look for God in the house. In the house, they saw a room and they looked for God in the room. And in the room, they saw a mirror and they looked for God in the mirror. As they looked in the mirror, they realized there was something special and amazing and about wonderful about being reflected in it. They turned around and ran home to home base calling out, we found God. God is in us. As this God appeared again and said, I had so much fun. Weren't these good hiding places? Some of you found me. Some of you weren't sure. And others are still looking, and that's okay, because the most important thing is just to play the game. Let's do it again. I'm sure I can think of some other good hiding places. And they all called out, "Ollie, Ollie, oxen free, free." And the game started all over again.
I'm going to start with a reading and then move into the a mindful prayer and meditation. The reading for this morning comes from the Reverend Victoria Safford, who just recently retired from our White Bear, Minnesota congregation. In a cemetery once, an old one in New England, I found a strangely soothing epitaph. The name of the deceased and her dates had been scoured away by wind and rain, but there was a carving of a tree with branches, a classic 19th century motif, and among them the words, "She attended well and faithfully to a few worthy things." At first, this seemed to me a little meager, a little stingy in the part of her survivors, but I wrote it down and have thought about it ever since. And now I can't imagine a more proud and satisfying legacy. She attended well and faithfully to a few worthy things. I mean, every day I stand in danger of being struck by lightning and having the obituary of the local paper say for all the world to see, "She attended frantically and ineffectually to a great many unimportant, meaningless details." And so I ask myself and I ask you, how do you want your obituary to read? "He got the dishes washed and dried before playing with his children in the evening. She balanced the checkbook with meticulous precision and never missed a day of work. Missed a lot of sunsets and missed a lot of love. Missed a lot of risk, but her money was in order. He answered all his calls, all his emails and voicemails, but along the way, he forgot to answer the call to service and compassion and forgiveness. She could not or would not hear the calling of her heart. And so, my siblings, how will it read? How does it read? And if you had to name a few worthy things to which you attend well and faithfully, what, I wonder, would they be?" And now I would invite us to join together in some moments of prayer and silent meditation. O eternal spirit of love and life and liberation, our prayer this morning is simple. Be our companion. Be our partner. When we are suffering personally and socially and internationally, bring us comfort, console us, be our companion. And when we feel blah or worthless, stir us to compassion, challenge us, remind us of our worthiness and our effectiveness in bringing contributions of joy and justice to this earthly planet. O Eternal One, be our companion. And may there be peace and unrest in our lives, sufficient peace to bring us calm and serenity and groundedness, but sufficient unrest to keep us spiritually awake and morally on our toes. Peace and unrest, unrest and peace. Shalom, Salam, Ashe, Namaste, Blessed be, and Amen. My deep gratitude to Reverend Jeremiah for inviting me to preach today, and to Amy Brunell for being my splendid worship associate, to Ryan, to Aubrey, for your whole team this morning. And thanks to each and every one of you Santa Monicans for being present either in the sanctuary or on Zoom. Thank you. Someday I hope to be able to return to your beloved congregation in person. Today I would like to dedicate this sermon on mindful dying to the blessed memory of two dear friends of mine, Maggie and Ernie Pipes. My two best male friends died recently, one eagerly wanting to halt a pain-saturated existence, and the other one passing away prematurely of an unexpected illness. We had covenanted for both of these younger brothers to speak at my memorial service, but lamentably, I ended up speaking at theirs. And this duo of heart-wrenching deaths has placed my own mortality front and center. And I'm reminded of Thornton Wilder's poignant line, "There is a land of the living and a land of the dead, and the bridge is love, the only truth, the only survival." Yes, only love conquers death. Nathan and Paul won't return in person, only in love. Only in love do I have them still. I'm sure you can identify with this feeling. My sermon title comes from a quote from the naturalist Wallace Stegner, who wrote, "I've been lucky. I came from nowhere and had no reason to expect as much from this one life as I've got. I owe God a death, and the earth a pound or so of chemicals. Now let's see if I can remember that when my time comes." Friends, you and I surely owe God, the universe, ourselves, and all whom we meet along the path, one death, especially following a full, generous existence. And it must be paid when it comes our time to return to the earth. To be sure, we adults have our own share of trouble with death. We tend to resist mortality at every turn. America clearly remains a death-defying culture, although we're getting a bit better. Note a recent ARP magazine lead article, front page, 20 ways to live longer. And I simply retort, how about 5 ways to live stronger, thicker, and more meaningfully? Will we face death in 10 weeks or 10 years or several decades? And what exactly will be the form of our greeting, and which particular indignities might be in store for you or for me? Well, whether death comes sooner or later as a relief or as an outrage, we humans need to be prepared. That means making sufficient peace with its inevitability. Friends, there's mindful eating, there's mindful working, mindful meditating, and mindful loving. There also needs to be mindful dying. Ironically, just when the world's great minds were beginning to accept that death is death, along comes a sane and respectable person by the name of Raymond Moody, with credentials in medicine and philosophy and psychiatry, who suggests that we should consider the phenomenon reported by people who've been clinically dead, but then resuscitated by modern emergency medical techniques. And their experiences have a lot in common and seem to suggest that the first stages of death appear to be spiritually positive. Many of those interviewed felt a feeling of peace and wholeness, and none of them has ever been afraid to die again. This is indeed reassuring news to any of us who've been frightened of what might happen to us following death. However, these common components, while intriguing, in no way provide conclusive evidence of an afterlife. We don't really know what goes on in the brain as the body begins to die. We're all making conjectures, aren't we? Even capable researchers. Personally, I've come to a sort of benevolent agnosticism on the question of life after death or life after life. I don't anticipate one. I don't hunger for one, but there just might be one. And as a universalist who believes in everlasting love, I harbor no worries. Because whatever happens when I die, love will be the container. That's where my mother and I grew to agree, she from the perspective of her Christianity, and I from the perspective of my Unitarian Universalism. Whether or not there's life after death, surely there is love after death, eternal love. As Beth Norton, the music, and Rebecca Parker, the lyrics, crafted in their poignant chant. There is a love holding me. There is a love holding you. There is a love holding all. We rest in that love. Whether death is final or not, it still remains real. Whether it's a transition or a conclusion, it still happens and needs to be reckoned with. As the World Health Organization reports, the world death rate is holding steady at 100%. I'll go further. Unless we make adequate peace with our own personal deaths, we'll tend to remain cautious, maybe even cowards, about life, all of its faces, the good as well as the evil. Consenting to die, as the poet W.H. Auden puts it, consenting to die is a critical awareness and conscious decision during our earthly journey. And so, as we say in our Unitarian Universalist memorial celebrations, right at the outset, Josephina Doakes has died. You and I are alive. So we know who's still breathing in the room and who isn't. Yes, the spirit may live on, but the body of the dead person has irretrievably expired, and that difference must be saluted rather than camouflaged in euphemisms like he's gone away or she's passed on or transitioned. In the Jewish burial ceremony, the family is urged to shovel dirt on the coffin of the deceased. And the thud of dirt on the coffin is blunt. It can jolt the heart. But hearing the thud impresses upon those surviving that this passage of death is utterly real. A fellow human being is being placed in the ground and never will return to touch and be touched by us physically. Death cannot be tamed. Death is unknown. Death is mysterious. Let's just say that death is death. As our UU poet laureate, Rick Mastin, used to bellow, "Hey folks, remember we're all terminal on this ward." Right. An essential key to living fully is acknowledgement of that fact. Death's not only inevitable, it's also natural in the overall sweep of things. About 500 million years ago, all of life was composed of algae and amoebas, of a unified, continuous existence, growing at one end and sloughing off at the other. And into that world of endless glob came the transfiguring event of death. Without death, life could never have risen out of the immortal slime. And now death and life are inextricably linked. Both constitute necessary and sanctified gifts of one supreme reality. For without death, there would be neither that which we love, nor the ability to love it all. But I'll go even further. Death is desirable as well as inevitable and natural, especially for those of us blessed with a robust and full existence. And I'm not merely referring to certain deaths that bring relief or release from agony. Let me explain a bit. Years back, I was a discussant on a TV show featuring a dialogue on immortalism. the philosophy that we can, we should, and we will live forever. The spokesperson for this approach of cryogenics seemed relatively unfazed by my remarks until I unabashedly announced that even if I could live forever in my current condition, I'd likely turn down the offer. I simply didn't hanker for everlastingness. He was incredulous, flabbergasted, and for the remainder of the dialogue, kept trying to persuade me that everyone who was anyone wanted to live forever. His exact words, "No one in their right mind really wants to die." And I said, "I do someday. Yes, I do." And I proceeded to elaborate. First of all, I said that I find most notions of eternal life or paradise singularly uninteresting. Oh, it'd be nice in many cases, not all, to reconnect with departed friends or loved ones, but not to entertain an interminable sameness of our bonds. And who wants eternal bliss without the presence of sorrow and struggle? Perpetual existence would prove oppressively bland. Did you ever hear an evangelist describe heaven in terms of the challenges waiting to be faced, or in terms of passion or toil or justice? No, it's always an Elysian Fields, a sort of Palm Springs with a year-round irrigation system. Heaven is characterized by terrible constancy with no further growth or change taking place, destitute of variation or wrestling. How boring, how eternally boring. To put it positively, death's presence intensifies my capacity to love and to my desire to create meaning. Every moment with which I'm blessed grows precious. My life possesses daily urgency and challenge because I won't always be around. I embrace life all the more because it's limited. My dad died at 81 and a half, so did my father-in-law. That's about the average length of a man's existence. And what leads me to believe in my 81st year, I'll get more than that number. That's another reason I'm wrestling mightily through poetry and songs, sermons, and workshops right now with Mindful Dying. The truth is that my recently published book, Making Peace with Our Own Death, has been first and foremost a gift to myself. So I praise a world that will not be forever. If it were to be here forever, if we were to be here forever, there'd be no real reason to take special notice of this irrepeatably fresh summer day of 2022. There'd be an eternity of such days to notice. So it wouldn't matter if we missed one or two, right? If we're going to live forever, it doesn't matter if we miss a person or two, right? There will always be time for other people if we have an eternity. No, I believe it's because we don't have an eternity with one another that we must seize the time for one another. And we treasure each singular season precisely because we just might not experience another one. How many of us would clean up the environment or belt out songs or grow a beloved community or travel the world or raise healthy children or volunteer at the homeless center or do anything of much importance if we believed we had an eternity in which to do it? I bet few of us. few of us. A good death permits us to be pretty much the same person dying as we were when we're alive. A good death doesn't mean I'll die peacefully, although I'd like that. A good death is more than going to sleep one night and not waking up, although I'll take that too. A good death is when I go back into the ground essentially clean of regrets and resentments, sufficiently serene, and with my goodbyes in order. Do you or I have something we want to say or be or do on our spiritual bucket list before we die? If so, let's get to it as soon as possible. What are we waiting for? Now is the time to come clean, current, connected, and caring in all our bonds and duties. And as for our personal legacy, I've come to recognize that my name won't last forever. Maybe sooner forgotten than I desire or imagine. And my labors and visions soon lost in the shuffle. And surely all my sermons and books will be taken to the dump, if not by my children or grandchildren, by somebody sometime along the line. But I do hope, as I bet you do, that our peculiar struggles and curious gifts will influence a slew of people in some small way for some span of time. During the home stretch, my siblings, we finally get the message that love, every love relationship ends in a loss. Through distance, divorce, departure, or death. We will die, and so will our comrades and loved ones. Yet we home stretchers experience those we've cherished living on in our souls after their earthly sojourns. We still stay aligned with the land of the dead, the territory of the ancestors through the medium of love. And there's more comforting news, certainly for us Unitarian Universalists. Just as we were graciously ushered into being as a gift beyond our earning, statistical miracles, so also there will be love, and I capitalize love, surrounding us after we die. Everlasting love is our Universalist phrase. There's no need to discuss or debate the particular form such love might take. Nobody knows. It's only important that we declare with unshakable fervor and hope that the very love that created us will surely caress and comfort us beyond our death into illimitable seasons. And so with quivering gratitude, I second the sentiment of the Song of Solomon from the Hebrew Scriptures, that love is stronger than death. Yes, love outlasts death. Good news indeed. And enough reassurance for this guy. So my fellow mortals, in the end, death's justice comes to everyone in order to make room for other creatures to birth on the scene. And so I personally resonate with the way that Wallace Stegner phrases life's conclusion in a mellow conversation he had with his friend James Hepworth. James, I've been lucky. I came from nowhere and had no reason to expect as much from this one life as I've got. I owe God a death and the earth a pound or so of chemicals. Now let's see if I can remember that when my time comes. Yes, indeed. We owe God, this indescribably marvelous universe, ourselves and all creaturely companions, one death, especially following a full and generous ride into elderhood. And may this debt be willingly and gladly paid when our time comes to re-enter the ground of all being. I say gladly because we're placed on earth to find and deliver joy. And when our light finally goes out, if we're fortunate, our souls will echo the glorious and soothing passage of scripture from Isaiah. For you shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains, the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. May it come to pass. May it come to pass.
Breathe, everyone. Breathe. This is our last Sunday to help another liberal congregation in Santa Monica. And while they're not UUs, they have done so much good work in our town. And I love that our offertory this month was to help another congregation. I love that we make that kind of work important in our community. I feel really proud of us, and I was really excited to tell my friends who go to Ocean Park Community Church that we were invested in their well-being. And they were quite stunned and quite taken aback that we cared about their roof falling in and we cared about their continuation. So every week we take a pledge and we do it to organizations who promote the work that we feel is important and advances our Unitarian Universalist principles. We take half, and then half, 50%, will go to the organization of choice, which this month has been the church in Ocean Park. This 99-year-old church has actually, as I said, had the roof cave in last year during COVID, and the rest of their ceiling is at risk of collapse. They've been dedicated to liberal values and working towards a society in their whole beingness. Their social justice actions have been doing things like working for women's rights, LGBTQIA plus rights, disabled community rights, and they've also done local action work like when we all had to save the pier. Anybody remember that besides me? And also rent control in Santa Monica. Their minister, the Reverend Janet Gallery McKeithen, speaking to her parishioners, said, "We can be different. We can be the best of who we are. Let's live out our values. Let's live out our gratitude. Let's be the best version of us as a community." We at UUSM can help this congregation open their doors again, so thank you for your generous support. To give a donation right now, you can text, for example, $10, GCC, or go to our phone number, and it's all online. You can also do our little fun codes, or we have it in the order of service. We also appreciate your donations to our congregations and all the good work we're doing here, like our Arizona redo. So we appreciate all that you do for community and helping us grow. I love that you picked this song. Did you know? I'm so impressed. be now doing hymn 1018.
Benediction comes to us from Alistair Shearer. In truth, everything arises in order to disappear. Everything we have, everything we think we are, must at some point be surrendered, for it is only on loan from the bounty of the divine.
And having you. I just had a last minute announcement come to my attention. The artist at our art wall is here today, so we get to meet her, and so I just wanted to tell you that's an awesome opportunity, and we want to welcome her and tell her how much we've enjoyed her art for the last month, so I love that. Don't forget, we have coffee outside, and we really want to meet you. We have a visitor's table. We want to get to know you, and you can sign up for camp, so that's awesome, okay? So take it away, my friend.